everybody. Happy Thursday. Now, today I'm doing an FAQ and I have two questions that I am going to answer. And both I haven't really talked about that much. So let's get going. And if you are new to the channel, welcome. And how you ask me questions for a potential video like this in the future is below my Monday video. So the video that will come out this coming Monday, in the comments below it, you can ask a question using the hashtag KatieFAQ or just, hey, Katie got a question. I always look through them. I have to approve them all. Or you can hop on my website, katiemorton.com, under Katie's videos at the top, the tab across the top, scroll down, Q&A for videos, hit it and ask your question there. So let's get going. First question says, hey Katie, I have questions about ECT and its side effects and or effectiveness. What is it like to get it and why do they recommend it for some people? Now, ECT, for those of you who don't know, is electroconvulsive therapy. And I'm just making sure I say that right, because when I was looking at it earlier, I kept in my head saying it wrong. Now, ECT is something that has been used since the 40s and 50s, but the thing that people, I think, misunderstand is how it's changed through over the years and how much more human they've made it. I know in the movies, like if you watch A Beautiful Mind and stuff, they have him going through ECT and his body shaking, and they put wood in his mouth and all this stuff, but it is very different now than it was then, although it is still one of the most effective treatments for depression. And the reason that they do it is when people have severe depression and they're a danger to themselves, or have been in and out of the hospital and have tried all these treatment options and everything and nothing has worked and the depression's getting worse and it's just not looking good in the future for them, they'll offer up ECT. So ECT is something that is usually, obviously everyone's situation is different. And if you are extremely suicidal and they're really worried about you, they try a medication, it doesn't help, they may refer you to ECT earlier rather than later. But it's usually one of the later in the game kind of things that they will refer you to do. And there are places that specifically do ECT treatment and you'll go there for it. Now the way that it kind of works, I'm just reading from my notes so I don't forget everything, is that they place electrodes on your scalp and a finely controlled electric current is applied while the patient is under general anesthesia. Now I want to make sure that you understand that you're under general anesthesia. So your muscles are completely relaxed and you're kind of asleep, for lack of a better term. And therefore, the only way you'd actually know that someone that's getting ECT nowadays while watching them get it done is maybe slight movements by their hands or feet. There's no full body convulsion. I believe they still do put something in between your teeth just so you don't bite your tongue potentially, but it is very much not as horrific as they have shown in movies. It's not what we used to think it is. It's much more controlled and much more just humane looking in general. Now the way it's usually given up to 3 times a week for a total of 2 to 4 weeks, depending on the severity of your depression. And what we know, the way that it affects our brain is it stimulates the parts of our brain that aren't usually producing enough dopamine or serotonin, which is leading to our depressive symptoms. Obviously everything is theorized, you know, we can't look at a brain exactly while we're doing it, but the controlled impulses help bring us out of depression, and this has actually one of the highest success rates of any treatment of depression. And so that is what ECT is and why they decide to give it to certain people. Now, it may, the side effects of it, as far as I know, and if anybody has any more information about the side effects, let me know, because I've only had two patients that were mine. And when I was in the eating disorder treatment center, we had a lot of patients who'd been through it. And the most common is short-term memory loss. So usually around the time you get the ECT and the actual memory of receiving ECT may be really difficult for you to recall. Some people get headaches, and that's about all that I've heard from people and all that I've read about. Those are the most common. It's not like it's wiping your memory from forever and ever. It's usually just right around when you receive the treatment. People have trouble recalling when they went in and for how long and when it was and what it was like. So those are the two most common. It's been very successful for my patients, so if your doctor's recommending it, I would encourage you to go, okay? Now, the second question, hey Katie, I have a question that could possibly be answered in one of your upcoming videos. Well, hey, here it is. What do you do when your parents don't believe in or support counseling for you? They're just like, pray, 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 and exercise. They're constantly talking down to those who struggle with depression and in an indirect way talking about me. I hate it, and I want help, but I can't get it at the moment. That can be really, really difficult. And the best thing that I would say, if you are young and you're underage and there's nothing that you can really do to get help on your own without your parents' approval, is online. That's why katiemorton.com exists, is because not all of us can get help when we need it, and it's a great resource to get support, to print out worksheets and workbooks, to kind of get your self-help game going. Now, I would encourage you to still reach out. Like I've said before in other videos, if you're over 12 years old and able to participate openly and well in therapy, like emotionally participate, and whatever, let's say your parents have insurance, or the person works on a sliding scale, or you go to a free clinic, however you're able to get there, you're able to pay for whatever the fee is to see the therapist, and there's a reason to not include your parents, like they're not supportive and you've asked and they won't get you help. You can still get help. If all of those things are happening, you can still find a therapist that will work with you. They're just gonna ask you about those things, and I would make sure they know before you actually go in for the appointment. When you make the appointment, let them know, but you can still get help. And also, school counselors are a great resource. Teachers are a great resource. And our, like I said, the online community in general, if you have questions about depression or worries or things like that, my community has been very supportive. A lot of people have wonderful insights. I have a ton of videos on it. And I know that it's not always perfect, but sometimes that's the best we can do. And we have to start somewhere. So that is what I would do. And I'd also start journaling as a way to vent out what you're feeling and going through and know that you're not alone. And if any of you have, you know, helpful websites and groups and things, let us know below. I know there are a ton of resources out there and available to those of us who need help and support, especially in the summertime when we maybe can't get a hold of our school counselor. But know that there are resources available. There are people out there to help. You just have to reach out and find them, and the sooner the better. Okay, I love you all. I'll see you, I don't know, Friday or Saturday with a journal topic. Bye!